Hello everybody, my name is Jilles Groenendijk, and today we're going to tell you about Arduino, and that's going to be Jura, and I'm going to tell you about the Raspberry Pi. Not that kind of Raspberry Pi, a different one. Okay. This is me, my wife, and my twins. Jura has an identical twin brother, not fully identical. He's not the geeking one. So we have a problem at home. If we do not have Netflix, we are going to be called because Jelle is not able to solve that one. It started off with a class at school, plus class. That's something I did because I thought it was not okay that Jure was reading Donald Ducks all day. So I started a plus class to give children extra inspiration. And I did it for 4 years. I did stuff like exploding cola Mentos fountains, but I wanted to do special stuff as well. So we went outside and looked for the ferns to see how compression was initiated. But one day I thought of my grandpa in the middle. It's my father, me, and the twin boys. And he has made a special box for me with like the flat battery, 4.5 volt, bells, lights, and sockets. And that inspired me more than any education I followed after that. So I wanted to create something just as inspirational as the box that my grandfather made for me. And this is what I came up with. At that time, the Raspberry Pi was released, so I created a box, have the Gamma saw nice plates of 30 by 30 from a 120 by 60 plate, and used a Pringles can, a Raspberry Pi, a display, a printer. Here it is, actually. It has a coin acceptor, which is, oh yeah, over there. It can sense 6 different kinds of coins. And the children could connect to the Wi-Fi network, create some Python scripts to have it done anything, and it itself could connect to the school network to obtain Wi-Fi, which you needed to install packages. Raspberry Pi was initiated at least with David Braben, and David Braben is the one responsible for Elite, this old flight simulator game. And recently he created a new one, Elite Dangerous. Very nice game, and it also works with Oculus Rift if you like. The Raspberry Pi comes in different shapes and models. There are different ones like the A and the B model, which have Ethernet, more USB ports, and over time they have some improvements. This one now has the 2 version, and which has a quad core, but the latest one is the 0, and I run into a guy in Japan who created a Raspberry Pi cluster board. And he's currently using it to use 16 Raspberry Pi Zeros in a cluster situation. And he is going to set up an Indiegogo because Kickstarter was too hard from Japan. This is the Raspberry Pi. It's basically a computer to enable children at school to work with computers, and not in the way that you have to type stuff in Word, but have to program and install your own operating system. So it's a basic computer that can be powered with your phone charger, which can hold your operating system on your camera card, and which can connect to a television for a screen. So this is actually all you need if you have the other devices. Except for all the things I just called, it also has a GPIO header. And that's something that Jure will come up to later, because it's actually a bridge to the Arduino. It has pins which you can use to trigger stuff. And that was actually what I need for my box. The Raspberry Pi can be set up in a different ways. So you can do it either the geeky way with the command line interface, but you could also just download a media center and just run it out of the box. So either like that or like that. I prefer character based myself. This is the GPIO bus. And the GPIO bus has digital pins. So you can either sense if something is switched or not, or you can trigger a light. It has no analog functionality, but it has a bus, I2C bus. And that bus enables you to connect multiple devices, like, for instance, an analog-digital converter. Or a screen, or LEDs, or multiple buttons. And if you look here, this is a special chip. This allows you to add 16 extra lights or buttons to the box. So I've used a couple of those. If you want to connect that yourself, you just need this is like a pin header, which with a cable connects to a Raspberry Pi. Just power the device, add the data and the clock to it, and you have a command on your Raspberry Pi to see what channel, 77 in this case, has the device, and you can talk to it with the library that you want. Another thing is that it has serial, but it does not have like RS-232 serial. It talks transistor to transistor logic, and the Raspberry Pi uses 3.3 volts for communication. So you have a console cable to your Raspberry Pi, and the Arduino, depending on the model, talks either 5 volt or 3.3 volt. And you should be aware that the stuff you buy communicates in the right level. Otherwise, you have to shift the levels. And this is an FTDI friend, which actually connects to the Raspberry Pi and creates a serial port on your computer. So this allows you to talk with a Raspberry Pi on the serial bus. Now over to my son.
Okay, hello, I'm Jurre Groenendijk, and I'm going to be telling you something about Arduino. Here you can see two devices, a Mindstorms EV3 and an Arduino Uno. They basically serve just about the same purpose, but as you can see, the price tag is slightly different. They both have their own I.O. boards. The EV3 has four input ports, so you can send like a sensors that a push sensor, ultrasound sensor, or something else. And then the other side, you can put a motor or something else to accept power. This is really useful because it's almost unbreakable, but it also limits your capabilities. For the Arduino Uno, however, it has 16 digital ports and six analog ports, sorry, which can be used for both input and output. This is really useful because you have a lot of possibilities, but it's also way more breakable, which we will see in a few slides next. Arduino itself has a lot of different models. For example, here you see the DigiSpark, which I personally prefer because of the price and the plug and play, it works directly. You can also do something with Domotica, with Wi-Fi, or Internet of Things. It's really useful. Okay, so here we have a little example of an Arduino code. It has a few sections. So we have the setup part, which is run once, which in this case you define the pin as output because it's going to be powering a LED. And you have the loop, which will repeat itself forever. In this case, it says, like, turn the LED on, wait a second, turn it off, wait a second, and it will blink. Here we have another example of input, which, again, in the setup, you say, hey, I'm input. And in the loop, you can check if the button is still pressed. Now, if you would just connect it to 5 volts and input, it would basically work, but for example, you upload the wrong code, it'll say this is output. It'll send power to an output, and your Arduino will basically just fry. It's dead. Rip all your money. So that's why you should have another ground pin connected so that whenever something like that happens, it will send away the power to the ground. Here we have another example, which uses both input and output. This is a Kit Knight Rider example. And yeah, the code works the same again. I don't have an example with me right now, but it's quite interesting. So. There's another really useful feature to the DigiSpark. It's a keyboard. So I can plug it in, and it will start doing stuff. I personally use it a lot to spam my friends or get a lot of commands at the same time, and it's quite funny to troll with. But you can also use it to, for example, hey, open up a Google Chrome page, open up Facebook, update status to, hey, I'm gay now. And yeah, that would actually work. And now here we have another example, a let's get it. A big LED board powered by the DigiSpark again, and a distance sensor. Whenever you hover your hand or something else over the distance sensor, it will start changing colors. And when you think, hey, I like the color, you can take away your hand, and it will stay that color until 13.37 seconds. It will go back. And again, that's all powered by this tiny little chip, the DigiSpark. Here we have another example. This one uses the DigiX. That's the LED board right there. Yeah. So you can connect to that, and it will act as a wireless access point, and it can go to the web address, and then there's an input field in which you can input the text, which will then be changed to whatever you input. It was a really fun project to make. And it's quite interesting. Whatever. So if you were to combine a few of these things, so an Arduino, some software, a few sensors, and a breadbox, you can get something amazing like this. This here is a device which I use to copy my school's access passes for the lockers. It's built up by a sensor with NFC. Battery pack, some other shields, LCD. And when we tried to build this, we ran into a few problems. So the first problem was that the software of the scanner we had would, whenever it sent something, it would say the first two bytes are 0x08 to make sure that it wasn't actually used for any malicious purposes. And the second problem was that the code we used later in the Linux part would not allow anything which was the zero block. So like the first two bits as well, if they were zero, they could be used with malicious intent as well. So the code itself wouldn't allow that. We found some fixes for this. We bought another scanner, which works on USB. We bought some specific tags which could actually be written. Sorry, the level. Touché. So we got some tags which were zero sector writable, so you could actually write the first two bits on there. And we also started programming in Linux. And that worked like a charm. So now instead of my path, I just have a MyFair tag on my keychain, which I can unlock my lockers with, which is really useful. I do this all for my school, and I'm doing this legally. I'm a white hat or pink hat hacker. And I've made some deals with my headmaster, so whenever I find something, I'll report it directly to him. Not allowed to tell anyone else, and he's gonna fix it, and I'll get a reward for that. However, I haven't gotten any yet, but I've victim thing, or whatever. I've done that after reading this book. It's called Helping Hackers by Chris van 't Hof. And it explains the basics of responsible disclosure with a lot of examples, which is really great. And yeah, that's just about it.
Okay, finally, we have a quiz for you. I got inspired not only by my grandpa, but also by some women. It's always nice to be inspired by some women. Do you know their names? First one is Lady Ada, or what's her real name? Yeah. Anyone else? Liam or Frieda? Heel goed. Any other faces familiar? Upper top is Lima Fried from Adafruit, and she has a very nice store and is a very nice inspiration with YouTube videos and Lego-like instructions. Sylvia Todd Maker Show, she made it up to Obama in his garden to make a printer that used water paint to print stuff. Geek Girl Diaries, she used to make stuff. Sylvia Todd first make stuff for younger children, like 8-9 year olds, and Carrie Ann makes stuff for children, for girls 15-16 year, so like a box that creates poems if you push a button. And Shannon Morse is from Hack 5, and these are the ones that inspire me, so go and visit their website. Another one is this one, the Arduino Basic Connections by Pichix, and it has a nice repository of all kinds of different circuits. So if you want to know a specific circuit, if you're not familiar with electronics, you can just get your hand on it, connect a PS2 keyboard to an Arduino, connect a VGA to an Arduino, switch 230 volt power, do whatever you like. I work on a makerspace, Zend Amateur Vereniging, radio something, yeah, radio amateur. And we have a link page, so www.electronicaclubzhe.nl, diverse Arduino links, they are all bundled. So the links to the girls in the top and some shops I usually get my stuff from. This is the link, and if you have any questions for either Euro or me, just fire it off. Yeah. Thank you.
You showed us a picture of the Raspberry Pi cluster. Could you give an example of what that would be used for?
Not yet. I heard someone for fuzzing applications. That could be one. The guy itself built it for provisioning USB sticks, so he actually used the USB side more than the network. Currently, the USB cluster board has a lot of network interfaces. And one of the people online instructed that if you use some kind of a special Realtek chip, you can just switch it on the board itself, and you only have two network cables for clustering, so you do not need an extra switch to power up the board. But yeah, anything that uses Beowulf cluster can be done on there.
Okay, very interesting. Thank you.
It was very hard for him to obtain the 16 zeros, because those were bundled with the Raspi Mach with a magazine, and they currently created 800 more, but they should make a lot more. People want those €5 for a computer, It lacks a network interface, Wi-Fi, and all those things, but there's a lot of purpose for it. Anyone else? So it's quite clear then. Okay, thank you very much.